Welcome, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm Susan Levine, director of the UIC Institute for the Humanities, and we're very happy to have you all here today. This program is part of the UIC Chancellor's Initiative in the Humanities, Food Studies at UIC, Local and Global Issues. The Chancellor's Initiative, along with the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences and the Institute for the Humanities, have been sponsoring a series of programs in food studies, including the Chicago Area Food Studies Working Group, a postdoctoral fellow in food studies in the humanities, and a lecture series entitled New Research in Food Studies. And you can find out information on all these programs on the Institute for the Humanities websites, which I urge you to consult. And we also have some of our posters in the back. Now, many people these days bemoan the fate of the humanities in the university. But I can tell you that here at UIC, the humanities are thriving in large part due to our world-class faculty and to the support of an administration that understands the humanities to be the heart and soul of a university education. I especially want to thank Chancellor Paula Allen Mears for her initiative in the humanities. I'd also like to thank Lon Kaufman, the provost of UIC, and Astrida Tantillo, dean of the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences. Finally, I also want to thank the Illinois Alumni Association and the staff of the Institute for the Humanities, especially our Associate Director, Linda Vavra, who you all met coming in, for help in the logistics and making this event possible. And I'd also like to greet the LAS Board of Visitors who are here with us today and some members of the Cousin family as well. And it's now my great honor to introduce our speaker today, Ertharin Cousin, Executive Director of the UN World Food Program, and also 2013 recipient of the UIC Alumni Achievement Award. Ertharin Cousin has worked for over 25 years in national and international nonprofit, government, and corporate leadership in focusing on hunger, food, and resilience strategies. Cousin grew up here in Chicago in the Lawndale neighborhood. She credits her mother, Annie Cousin, with instilling in her a spirit of service. She says, "We didn't have a lot, but we still felt the responsibility to share with others." Cousin received her BA from UIC in 1979 and her JD degree from the University of Georgia School of Law in 1982. She worked in the Illinois Attorney General's office and in 1994 went to work as White House liaison to the State Department. And in 1996, she became senior advisor to the Secretary of State at the Olympic Games in Atlanta. Ertharin Cousin has worked both in nonprofit and in business sectors. In 1997, she was appointed to the board of the International Food and Agricultural Development, and she also served as vice president for government and community affairs for a large local grocery store chain here in Chicago. In 2002, she joined the board of the directors of Feeding America, which is now America's Second Harvest, one of the nation's largest food banks and food relief nonprofits. In this capacity, she led food relief efforts during Hurricane Katrina. In 2006, Cousin left Feeding America to found and serve as president of the Polk Street Group, a public affairs consulting firm based here in Chicago. But the world of food aid called her back, and in 2009, she accepted President Obama's appointment as U.S. representative to the United Nations Agencies for Food and Agriculture in Rome. And in 2012, she became executive director of the United Nations World Food Program. And I want to say a couple words about the World Food Program, but I'm sure you'll say much more by way of introduction. The UN World Food Program was established in 1961 as a multilateral food aid program. The agency now reaches over 90 million people with food assistance in 80 countries each year, and you might update those figures. I don't know if they're up to date. The World Food Program goal is to eradicate hunger and malnutrition and ultimately to alleviate the need for food aid entirely. When asked what her greatest priority is, Cousin replied, "We don't have the luxury as humanitarian actors to prioritize one child over another, one hungry person over another. Our responsibility is that we raise the resources and provide the support that is necessary to meet the food assistance needs of a hungry child, a poor person, wherever they are in the world." One of Cousin's major goals in leading the World Food Program has been to transform it from food aid organization to food assistance. The outcome we've been working to achieve, she says, is that we're helping, we're helping the family or the community fill the stomachs of the hungry poor during the time of crisis, but we're also providing them with the tools or the assistance and the capacity so that they, as they move forward, they have sustainable and durable food security so they can feed themselves in the future. As the head of the World Food Program, Ertharin Cousin emphasizes that food security is the key to many of the conflicts in the world today. She says of the Syrian situation, for example, when people are hungry, when a mother or father is facing a child that they can't feed, you can't ask that family to lay down their arms. They won't, because the one thing a family is going to fight for is the ability to save their children. And we know that food is required to save a child's life. So providing the food assistance that's necessary is a big part of ensuring that the parties will continue to work towards a sustainable political solution. So Ertharin Cousin is going to speak to us today about delivering food assistance in a shrinking humanitarian climate. Please join me in welcoming her.
When you sit through an introduction like that, and thank you very much, Susan, for the very kind introduction, you say, God, I wish my mother was here. I do appreciate that kind introduction. Chancellor, thank you so much for coming here today and taking time out of what I know is a very, very busy schedule to spend a bit of time with us this afternoon. I am really pleased to be here, and I want to do what every parent would do at this moment, and that is to embarrass my son and let you all know that I do have an adult child who has blessed me with wonderful grandchildren, and it's so much more fun being a grandparent than it is being a parent. But it makes doing this work tough because I'm not here very often and they're growing like weeds, but it makes coming home a pleasure. And so I appreciate you for finding time in your busy schedule as well to come and support me during this period. I was originally expecting my mom and my siblings and everybody to come, but they gave me the choice. They could either they were going to come for the speech or they're coming for the dinner. So I said, come for the dinner. I said, the speech this afternoon is going to be intellectually interesting, but tonight's the party. So I was pleased that my son said, I'm doing both. So, and I didn't even pay him for that. So it is really great. It is a pleasure to be here with the members of the university community. I had the opportunity to spend an hour or so with students over in the humanities building. And I didn't give a speech to them. I just let them have at me for an entire hour. And I gotta tell you, Chancellor, you should be proud. They were spectacular. They asked tough, smart, interesting, well thought out questions that demonstrated that you are still doing a great job here at UIC of preparing the next generation of leaders. And so I was pleased. I said that last month I was a speaker at the London School of Economics, and those students did not ask any questions that were any better than the students that asked me questions today here at UIC. So be proud. I was proud. I was proud. Okay, as an alumna, I was proud. So you're doing a great job. So I want to thank you all for taking time out of your schedule and giving me the opportunity to discuss these what we all believe as humanitarian is a very important issue today, and that is the shrinking humanitarian space. But first of all, as the executive director of the World Food Program, which is 100% voluntarily funded, I have a responsibility to tell you a bit more about what we do at the World Food Program. But before I start, I'm in a university setting, and I don't have a blackboard behind me, so the best thing I can do is show you a video to give you a sense of what we do. If I can ask you to cue the video and to turn the lights down a bit, this tells a great story about what we do at the World Food Program. Thank you. We do this work, but we don't do it alone. We work with about 2,000 NGOs, both international NGOs and local NGOs. We work with local governments. We work with donor countries and their taxpayers who support our efforts, because the majority of our funding is government funding. And so in times of tight financial crisis, we are even more challenged in ensuring that we perform the work that provides the benefits that are necessary to those that we serve, to ensure that your taxpayer dollars, and I say your taxpayer dollars because the United States of America is our largest contributor year in, year out since the program was founded in 1950, since the program was founded 50 years ago in 1961. And so, but it's not enough, because as you saw, we feed 100 million people. There are 842 million people who are chronically food insecure. And we use the term food insecurity in the global community, but too often we fail to define it. So I'm in the university. Food insecurity is the inability to access food that is required to lead a healthy and productive life. Simply stated, the ability to avoid going hungry. And as you noted on there, last year we fed almost 100 million men, women, and children in over 75 countries. But we are working to go beyond just feeding people and to helping people feed themselves, because the reality of it is we cannot and will not have the ability to continue to provide resources to people if we don't give people the ability to move beyond the need for accessing those resources. But the challenge is that that requires investment, that requires capital. We raise and spend about $4.2 billion a year. Our needs budget is about $6.5 billion a year. So that means that's a lot of people that we don't reach, a lot of families that we can't help, a lot of women who, as you saw, and they're working very hard to begin to increase their yields and the quality of those yields so that they can feed their own families. But we continue to perform the work. The majority of communities that we work in, because we do target the most vulnerable and the most hungry, because, and we're often asked, how do you select? Why doesn't it make, when one of the students asked me this, wouldn't it make more sense to focus on the family that's just fallen below the line? They've got a better chance of getting over. I said, the reality of it is, we don't have enough resources to do that. We must focus on the child and the family, that if they don't receive support from us, that child, that family will go hungry, that child may starve. We would love to spend more resources on helping those who just need a little bit of help, but we require and we support others by providing them with capacity development assistance to support those families. So we do focus on the most fragile places, the poorest communities in the world. And too often, the reason people are hungry is because of conflict. And these are the places where the degree of complexity involved in providing access to food increases exponentially every year. Think of places like Afghanistan, Syria, Pakistan, Sudan, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Somalia. Those are some of our largest programs. In countries like these, we often find the greatest need for humanitarian assistance for food. But it's also where we find the most difficulty in accessing populations across what are often very fluid front lines in the midst of a complex political and often militarily changing dynamic. These are the places where the humanitarian space is most under threat and where access to people in need is critical for saving lives. Chancellor, did you know that in the last 40 years, conflicts have cost up to 1 million lives per year? And most of the casualties from those conflicts have been civilians, not combatants. Far too often, those civilians who survive find themselves without shelter, without water, and without access to food. They suffer from food insecurity and hunger. Today, I speak to you as a humanitarian, and I am a humanitarian who is concerned, as I hope by the time we leave here today, each one of you will share my concern with the increasing threat to humanitarian space. As we sit here this afternoon, we are acutely mindful of the events taking place in Syria. This escalating conflict, with its disparate armed groups, ethnic cleavages, and constantly shifting front lines, where we are just as aware of other conflicts and prolonged crisis affecting too many women and children in Afghanistan, northern Mali, Somalia, Yemen, and the prolonged crisis in the DRC, where women in the DRC today live in fear of being raped as a weapon of the conflict even more than they fear death. These events remind us of the importance of humanitarian space and our responsibility to protect those living in conflict zones or trying to live in conflict zones. This afternoon, I'll focus on some of the real-world implications of contemporary threats to the humanitarian space. And as I talk, I ask you to ponder, what can we do together as a community of students, teachers, academics, researchers and practitioners, people who care to defend humanitarian space in our increasingly complex and global environment? So, I'd like to first spend a bit of time describing what we mean by the concept of humanitarian space and why it is so important. I'll then provide an overview of some of the main challenges to this space that are emerging in many of the countries where WFP is currently working. I'll also share some of the concrete examples with you to illustrate how we have overcome most of these challenges to reach populations in need. And in closing, what I would propose is some suggestions on what we need to do, what we must do to defend our humanitarian space and to uphold the humanitarian principles. So, to begin, what do we mean by the concept of humanitarian space? International humanitarian law, essentially the Geneva Conventions and their two 1977 protocols, requires that in an armed conflict, that civilian populations, too often women, men, children, seniors, who lose their provisioning capacity, their ability to access food because of the conflict, their ability to access water because of the conflict, the ability to meet their daily needs, that the humanitarian principles require free and unhindered passage of supplies delivered by humanitarian actors to those civilians in need. Simple enough. People are hungry, there's war, we must get to those people to provide them with assistance. A baby should not die when there's assistance available because we cannot reach them. That's humanitarian space. Those supplies must be delivered on the basis of the three principles of humanity, impartiality, and neutrality. The application of these three principles is not a matter of idealism. First, the principle of humanity requires us to address human suffering wherever it is found. We can't decide to feed the children on one side of the battle line and not the children on the other. Wherever they are, we have responsibility for feeding them all. Second, the principle of impartiality states that assistance will be guided solely by need and we will not discriminate in terms of ethnic origin, nationality, political opinion, gender, race, or religion. Third, the principle of neutrality states very clearly that humanitarian organizations will not privilege any party to a conflict. I am so often asked in Syria, are you feeding on the rebel-held areas or the regime-held areas? I said, we feed everyone. The reality is, however, in the besieged areas, the conflict areas where the bullets are flying, we can't get into those spaces. And I'm often asked, whose fault is it that you can't get into those spaces? I said, bullets don't come with an identity. They don't say they came from the regime side or they came from the opposition side. So what we demand is that all parties provide the necessary humanitarian access. At the time that these principles at the time of the Geneva Conventions, this 1949, this was an incredible achievement. In the history of humanity, you are humanities professors. You understand this. We did not have international norms around how belligerents in conflict were required to perform. It wasn't until 1949 that the global community agreed that never again would we have a war where civilians suffered the way they did. And we were able to come together as a global community to define the humanitarian principles. And they has emerged as a guide to the conduct of humanitarian actors to support those who would be the victims of a conflict, outlining the responsibilities to protect and to provide for those in need of assistance. However, many of the conflicts in the world today do not involve standing armies from sovereign states across borders, squaring off in a battlefield. If you think about the many contemporary conflicts, we see that combatants are often embedded within civilian populations. Front lines are often defined by control over urban neighborhoods. Allegiances are increasingly defined as much by linguistic and religious identity as they are by affiliation with a sovereign state. The number of non-state armed actors, ranging from ethnic militias to international terrorist movements, has also proliferated in recent years. As a result, the need to develop innovative means for negotiating with these different, very, very different actors, who may not even be aware of international legal principles, has become a priority for humanitarians. At the same time, certain states have become increasingly suspicious, particularly of what they perceive as Western humanitarians. Sometimes humanitarian action is equated with attempts to delegitimize a state. The expulsion of many NGO partners from Darfur following the indictment of Sudanese President Omar al-Bashir by the International Criminal Court is a case in point here. They thought we were on the wrong side, so maybe we should be under attack as well. We're also seeing an increasing politicization of humanitarian space as both armed state and non-state actors seek to manipulate humanitarian assistance in line with their own narrowly defined political and security objectives. The refusal to allow access to populations and territory held by the opposing armed group, the introduction of administrative obstacles and delays, the targeted looting of assistance may be used to prevent and hamper the flow of assistance to populations in need. Let me use Syria again as an example here. In Syria today, in the Deir ez-Zor region of Syria, we have people in need. That area, unfortunately, is under the control of al-Nusra, which is an Islamic militant organization and one of the combatant groups in participating in the conflict. They have, on two separate occasions now, which is two is too many, but when you have 1,400 caravans a month, two people say we should be okay with that. But on two separate occasions, we've had them take the goods from our trucks and distribute them themselves with signs that said, a gift from al-Nusra to the people of Syria. And attempt to politicize our aid. And so we are then required to negotiate with them in order to get the aid back and to ensure that there is no politicization of that aid. So there are real world challenges that impact each of these terms. In recent years, many commentators have noted the blurring of the lines between the neutral provision of humanitarian assistance to populations in need and the national security priorities of donor governments. A recent comment from the Journal of Humanitarian Assistance suggested that the threat to humanitarian action has been most pronounced where major humanitarian donors, and you could think about that, major humanitarian donors have also implemented counterinsurgency campaigns in these same areas where they are contributing to the humanitarian support for our organizations and also investing in counterinsurgency campaigns in the same territories. Think about that. Assistance may be equated with the winning of hearts and minds, and the potential to see us as politicizing based upon one side or another or a third party donor country. As a consequence, the humanitarian space is further constrained, and there can be an increased risk of violence against humanitarians as well as civilians. The threat of violence is a key concern for the defense of humanitarian space. The number of violent attacks against aid workers has more than tripled since 1997. The number of aid workers that have been killed in the line of duty almost doubled, and the number of kidnappings has more than tripled in the same period. Over two-thirds of these attacks were committed in a small number of countries, including the countries we listed before: Afghanistan, Somalia, Sudan, South Sudan, Pakistan, DRC, and Iraq. These are the very places, as I noted in the beginning, where need is often the greatest. And these are the very places where we find humanitarian space is often the most constrained, and we as humanitarian workers face the greatest risk to our security. I will tell you, there is nothing worse than calling a child to tell them that, to tell that child that her father has been kidnapped by insurgents in attempts to deliver humanitarian assistance, and that we don't pay ransoms. Hardest call I ever had to make. In addition, greater demands on the wider UN system present additional unique challenges to humanitarians. Over the last two decades, the UN has undertaken a series of institutional innovations to promote greater coherence and more efficiency in conflict and post-conflict engagements. This attempt at efficiency has resulted in greater cooperation across political, security, development, and humanitarian pillars, but it has confused the relationship between who are the people providing the political and security assistance from the United Nations with who are the people who are providing the humanitarian assistance. As a result, maintaining the distinction between humanitarian and peacekeeping elements of the UN system is becoming ever more significant challenge. I'll come back to this when we talk about DRC. I've already mentioned that humanitarian principles are not ends in and of themselves. Rather, humanitarian principles are the most effective means for protecting the humanitarian space and ensuring access to populations in need. How are these principles applied in reality? At WP, our basic philosophy is a quote-unquote principled practice. Principled because WP upholds the dictates of the international humanitarian law, and our work is always guided by those three principles: humanity, impartiality, and neutrality. Practice slash reality, because our operations on the ground are based on the realities of the situations in the theaters of conflict. As a result, they are rarely, rarely ever simple. We must develop solutions that are appropriate to the complexity of a given situation on the ground. The tension between the need to deliver life-saving assistance and to assert humanitarian principles is one of the most significant challenges that we face today at WFP. There is no rule book to guide us in striking what is the right balance. It is a constant effort that plays out differently every day in our organization. Sometimes, for example, requiring my engagement with heads of state, foreign ministers, policy leaders, media, but more often than not, it requires the judgment, creativity, diplomatic skills of that man or woman working on the ground. Too often, it's the driver of the truck, it's the leader of the convoy who's talking to the combatant at a checkpoint about why they need to get through, or how they need to get through, or what's on the other side. You could say that this tension is a balance between theory and practice, or between theory and reality. Let me briefly give you an example of the challenges, real world challenges, to space in humanitarian space in Pakistan. And then I'll move on to a couple of other examples, including DRC, but in Pakistan. On Monday, October 5th, 2009, at almost a quarter past noon, a young man came to the gate. And if you go and visit any of the UN offices, the NGO offices, the government offices in any of these countries, they are fortified facilities. And our office in Pakistan was no different. And so a young man disguised as a soldier approached WFP's office, which at that time was in a residential district of Islamabad. He knew that that security was extremely tight. The outer security post was manned by armed police and private security guards. So he waves to a Frontier Corps guard as he walks past. How you doing? Good morning. Good to see you. How are you? To avoid the mandatory screening process at the main gate, he asked for a glass of water and then requests to use the bathroom. And they let him around the side. He's admitted to the compound through a side gate without going through the metal detectors. He enters the lobby, and as he walks in, the office explodes. Boom. Five of our staff were dead, scores more were injured. Fast forward, April 17, 2010, less than a year later after that attack on our office. WFP's beneficiaries were crowded in a distribution point in Kohat, west of Peshawar, in northern Pakistan. Two explosive devices go off. Many, many of our beneficiaries were injured in that blast. Those not injured were clearly shaken and frightened and now afraid to come to WFP for service. We operate in a global environment in which increasing levels of violence against humanitarian staff and the populations we serve represent one of the most significant challenges to humanitarian space. At the same time, we have an obligation to prevent and alleviate hunger and must weigh these obligations against concerns related to respect for life, health, and dignity. Then and now, the choice is difficult, sometimes seemingly impossible. The choice of whether to evacuate based on security concerns and the humanitarian principles alone, or to adjust our risk profile and find some way to stay and to deliver. In Pakistan, to protect our staff, we moved to a new office where we could better manage the security risk. And we also set up new protocols that you can't allow people to come in and have water without going through the magnetometer. To protect our beneficiaries, we established new approaches to increase safety at distribution sites. We also developed guidelines for partners to support appropriate site selection. We instituted several levels of security perimeters at distribution sites, and we established a complaints desk that allows beneficiaries to notify us directly of potential security concerns. Because the other thing that we heard was that some of the beneficiaries didn't come to the distribution point that day because they knew there was an attack plan, but they had no way of telling us. And so now we've set up a mechanism that gives them the ability to inform us. We use that information to ensure that we conduct distributions based on community feedback, respecting the safety and dignity of the people we serve. As a result of these measures, in 2010, that same year of the explosions, we were able to reach over 8.8 million people at a time when the massive floods swept through the northern part of Pakistan. We kept working. And WFP continues to work to prevent and alleviate hunger in Pakistan. 2 months ago, I, as leader of WFP, was able to walk in these same communities with the leaders and to sit with the women who told me their babies were healthy because WFP provides them with safe and nutritious food. We stayed and we delivered and we're making a difference. We are doing everything reasonably possible to reduce the risk of violence against our staff and the people who count on us to meet their food needs. But meeting the food needs is different in every circumstance. In the Democratic Republic of Congo, on November 15, 2012, fighting again, and I say again because any of you who follow these issues know that in that part of the world, in the DRC, fighting has been going on for far too long. So it erupted again on November 15, 2012, between the National Army of the Democratic Republic of Congo and the rebels affiliated with M23 around the provincial capital of Goma in North Kivu. Although the UN had a peacekeeping operation in the area, MONUSCO, their forces were outnumbered and unable to provide protection to many of the civilians caught between the opposing forces. Within hours of the start of fighting, the refugee camp in the area for internally displaced persons near Goma, with a population at that time of 60,000 people, was completely emptied. In less than 12 hours, people scattered out into the woods. In South Kivu, another 130,000 people were displaced. During this fighting, 160 civilians were killed. The M23 occupied Goma for 11 days. The number of rapes of women increased tenfold during that period. The outcry was immediate and widespread. There were demands for the UN peacekeeping mission to offer greater protection to the beneficiaries and to the humanitarians. And they did. They gave MONUSCO then the authority to fight back, which they didn't have before. So in March 2013, the Security Council authorized the formation of an intervention brigade, which was mandated to take offensive action to end the conflict. The more aggressive profile of this UN intervention brigade carries certain risk for humanitarian actors, particularly for UN actors and their partners, as perception of neutrality by the N23 when they look at MONUSCO versus WFP or UNICEF, what's the difference? So this, our neutrality may be compromised by this new force. This is where things become complicated for humanitarian agencies in the context of UN integrated missions. WFP and other UN agencies depend on MONUSCO to provide protections to civilians as well as security for humanitarian staff and assets in some of these situations. If you remember, the principle of neutrality states very clearly that humanitarian actors do not take sides in conflict. However, under the new intervention brigade is now actively pursuing the M23 rebels. By working with MONUSCO, who's pursuing the M23, we may be seen as partisan and not upholding the principle of neutrality. Yet, if we do not afford ourselves the protection, we are putting lives at risk. What do we do? We must take concrete and pragmatic steps to ensure that armed groups and civilians perceive WFP partners as neutral. In a place as vast and complex as Eastern Congo, this is not a simple task. So they wear black helmets, we wear blue. They have black lettering on their trucks, we have blue. We are doing as much as we can to address these concerns, to ensure that we maintain access to food and secure populations safely. We are working with the UN Department of Peacekeeping Operations to determine ways to ensure that humanitarian agencies are perceived as clearly distinct. In addition to changing color of helmets, making sure they're different, we've established separate public information and advocacy mechanisms and how we talk and we don't present together. We're also engaging directly with communities to ensure that civilians are able, as noted, to distinguish humanitarian elements of the UN system from MONUSCO. And sometimes it's still not enough, but the reality of it is it's a balancing act every single day because we must be there But the situation requires that we must also be protected. And even more importantly, that the women and children that we serve are protected. So, finally, the situation in Syria, a topic that is clearly dominating the attention of the international community at the moment. I remember, in fact, in mid-2011, seeing the very first shaky amateur videos. You all saw these. You remember when it was the start of the Arab Spring in Syria, and we saw YouTube videos and Facebook videos of the civil war, what was then just a conflict in the streets, in Damascus, and in Aleppo, and in Homs. And I recall the empty streets and the smoke rising from behind apartment buildings in the distance. But by the year's end, hundreds of thousands of refugees had crossed the border into the neighboring country. And at that same time, we knew that the majority of people in need were still inside Syria. When I began my post in April of 2012, we were serving less than 150,000 people inside Syria. One of my first responsibilities as executive director was to amend the Syria program to increase it to 250,000 people inside Syria. As the front lines changed, as the opposition group began their offensive towards Damascus and Aleppo, and as the government launched its counteroffensive, we continued to ramp up distributions. As the conflict has further evolved, today, there are more than 2 million Syrians refugees living in the five neighboring countries outside Syria. And there are an estimated 5.8 million people in need of assistance inside Syria who are internally displaced, many of them having moved two and three times in an attempt to find safety. This month, WFP is working to feed 4 million people inside Syria and another 1.7 million people outside Syria, from 250,000 to 6.5 million people. The complexity of providing assistance inside the country has grown exponentially. There are still people in besieged conflict areas, primarily near the border with Turkey, in rural Damascus, in the El Haisakai region, in Aleppo, that we cannot reach because we do not have access from inside Syria. Recognizing this need, some call for humanitarian agencies to consider new options, including cross-border operations. Yet WFP has been unable to take that unilateral action to go across a border of a sovereign state of Syria because we are a UN organization that is the organization run by member states, and we must return. And the Assad government has not yet given us permission to provide support across borders. But about 10 days ago, the United Nations Security Council agreed upon a presidential statement, and Section 13C of that statement requires all parties to promptly facilitate safe and unhindered access to people in need through the most effective ways, including across lines and, where appropriate, across borders from neighboring countries, in accordance with the UN guiding principles of humanitarian emergency assistance. That is a quote. Now, the realities of the principle practice that we just talked about have truly begun to come into play. At every level, we are working to negotiate a positive effect to those we serve as a result of this new presidential statement and working to achieve a more positive result because the realities on the ground is often setting aside the legality of that statement. So what would be the likely consequence of WFP undertaking a decision without the government's authority to go across border? By negotiating access with the government and the opposition groups, we are able to reach the 4 million people, the 3 million people, and working towards the 4 million that we talked about. If we went across the border without their authority, you think they'll keep talking to us and giving us that access that we need? So we can serve the 70,000 on the border or the 3 million inside, 4 million inside that we're working to support. So we're exploring a negotiated option in support of the Security Council statement to avoid jeopardizing that our access to that 3 or 4 million in our attempts to meet the desperate needs of the 70,000. Adopting an approach of principled practice means that this position will continue to change with changing circumstances. The situation will evolve as factors and considerations on the ground continue to evolve. For the moment, in looking at the totality of the humanitarian response, I am confident that we are upholding the principle of impartiality and reaching the largest number of those in need in very difficult circumstances. Yet, this afternoon, yesterday, tonight, as more amateur videos continue to emerge, the situation in Syria continues to deteriorate. Inside Syria, more areas are becoming inaccessible. The upsurge in violence and the proliferation of checkpoints around major cities has affected the pace of our food dispatches and our very ability to get into some communities. In the rural Damascus area, in a city called Ma'atamiya, we have not been in there in 10 months. And we are beginning to see images come out of there of babies dying. So what will it take? What can we do? As a community, as thought leaders, as you listen, I'm hoping you have all now become part of that thought leadership and will help us safeguard the humanitarian space. We must resist every effort to politicize the humanitarian space. The most important issue before us is the encroachment of political agendas. Humanitarian action must be delinked from security agendas of state and non-state armed answers. And the only way to accomplish this is through dialogue. Asserting humanitarian principles and the right to access population requires constant dialogue at all levels, from the Security Council, the General Assembly, host governments, as well as the leaders of the rebel groups. This dialogue and understanding are the most effective means of defending humanitarian space. We can also examine the transfer of risk in operations more closely. Humanitarians are increasingly required to provide assistance in persistent, intractable conflicts where security risks are incredibly high and where the international community has often limited capacity to resolve the conflict through negotiation. In this situation, there is a need to greater share risk across the entire humanitarian community, including member states, donors, UN agencies, NGO partners, and others. When these risks are shared, we have greater transparency, improved communication, realistic expectations about what we can achieve working in some of the world's most hostile conditions. In these challenging situations, we must also protect the lives of the people who are out there serving, saving lives. They are mothers and fathers of their own children as they work to save the lives of other children. So they are also too often the victims that we must think about when we defend humanitarian space. And I say this with such passion because in certain parts of the world, there is virtual impunity for violence against aid workers. We must, in those situations, look at ways in which the international legal mechanisms could be used to bring perpetrators of these crimes to justice. Greater deterrence would not only serve to provide greater protection to those providing humanitarian assistance, but also as a direct consequence would ensure access to humanitarian assistance by vulnerable populations. If we're taking action against the bad guys will be less likely to take action against us. But if they think they can act with impunity, why not? This will only occur if governments and political actors and people who care, like each of you sitting in this room, demand unfettered humanitarian space with a willingness to use the tools at your disposal. And you do have tools at your disposal: communication tools, political tools, legal tools, to ensure we carve out and protect the space necessary to serve those in need. Building political will requires that those with power hear your voices. You and those like you must care if leaders are expected to care. In closing, ponder a thought. A thought that is perhaps a bit more theoretical. Humanitarian space does not exist in and of itself. Like many concepts, it is a man-made construct with real-world implications. We create it out of necessity, and it is very much ours to defend. It didn't exist before 1949. So if it's to mean anything as the world changes, we must defend it. And if we fail to do this, if we fail to proactively defend the humanitarian space from political interference by both state and non-state actors, if we fail to assert humanitarian principles and the right to assist populations, then we also fail humanity. And in failing humanity, babies, women, the sick, the elderly go hungry, and they ultimately die. I think that is something that none of us here today are prepared to accept. So inaction, not caring, is not an option. Those who are in need depend upon us. Thank you. Thank you for your time, your attention. I'll now stop and answer questions. I ended on such a somber note that we were in the back and we were preparing for the presentation, and I said, but we do good stuff too. All of it's good, but we do things that where we also work with children who are happy and healthy, and we're making a difference, and we are getting closer to helping people feed themselves. So I just want to share a bit of a more uplifting video with you before we go into the Q&A. Can we play the video?
I'm in association with the UN.
We are the stars up in the sky.
1 in 8 people go to bed hungry every night. The time for us to do something is now. Together, we can end world hunger.
Now we have wings, we can fly. We can be kings tonight. Wipe away the tears from our eyes. We light up the sky. Now we have wings, we can fly. We can be kings tonight. Wipe away the tears from our eyes. We light up the sky. All of the road ahead was long.
Donate at these participating restaurants today.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky.
All right, that's all I got, that's all. It's not dancing, but... Oh, you know the song?
It's time for us to do something about it. Visit hungertohope.com.
These are all our children. And we live on a very small planet. And we don't have the luxury of not caring. Thank you all very much.